Birders, Jim and Steve, EarlyBirder.net. Welcome back for another educational series episode.
Yep.
We're just going to be talking about kind of the common gear that you want to get as you go out birding. And with all this stuff, you can start really, really, really simple. We've said that before, but it really doesn't cost a lot to get going.
Yeah.
And then as you go, you can always start with cheaper options and build up if you're interested. You know, if you find that you're really into whatever it is, into the birding, into the hiking, and adapt whatever your gear happens to be, adapt it to what you really enjoy doing. So
yeah, whatever gets you outside, you just, you know, invest in that, and then if it interests you enough, you'll just keep modifying your equipment. So
absolutely. So we'll start with the basics. Like, no matter what you're doing, when you start birding, you want to start with a guide. And we had a whole episode on guides, but it's important to have a guide so that you know what it is you're looking for.
Yeah.
This one's got all kinds of tabs in it because I've gone through and bookmarked. Some of them have tabs built in so that you can quickly get to specific types of birds. So if you're looking for woodpeckers, there's a tab. If you're looking for, you know, ducks, there's a specific tab for that.
Yeah. Aside from, like, the clothing you need to walk outside, if you have nothing else, you need a guide. Or at least somebody who has one that you can borrow one from, or just somebody who's already a birder. If you have someone who already, you know, has stuff, you can go out. But if nothing else, you need to know what it is you're looking for.
And a lot of times you can find them at used bookstores or thrift shops or yard sales or whatever.
Yeah.
The other option, instead of having a physical guide we've talked about, is having an app on your phone. Yeah. It's kind of quick and easy. If you really don't have the money and you really don't want to spend any money, but you're still interested in just seeing if you like birds, you can do simple Google searches and things like that for a lot of the common birds. It'll be good enough that you can identify them.
Everyone's got a phone nowadays. I mean, you can, if you can record video or take a picture or something like that, you can cross-reference it online. And then we're talking about birding specifically. You don't need any of this stuff just to enjoy birds. You don't have to know what it is to enjoy it. But we're talking about going out and identifying birds. You got to have a guide. And then everything else that follows, I think, just makes it easier.
Right. You're adding to it just to help you identify stuff. Yeah. So next in the list that I think is just getting a journal so you can keep track of your sightings. And it doesn't have to be real expensive. You know, I got, you know, the fake leather one here, but you can just keep it simple.
Yeah.
It can be a little notepad. You can keep, take notes on your phone, you know, if you're on your way.
Yeah. Draw pictures. I mean, that's how the early naturalists did this kind of stuff.
I just kind of write the species, the month or date that I go out, I usually write down along with it, and then it makes it easier for tabulating everything, kind of keeping track of it all year by year. And you can look back and you can be a lot more detailed, put down where you were when you saw it, what time of year, what time of day, and that'll help you find the same species year after year if you go back looking for the same thing, or you've got friends that come up to visit and they don't bird in your area, then you know where to go to find those species that may maybe for them are lifers, you know, they never see them at all.
Some people really thrive on that data. Some people have decades of notebooks that have what species they saw and where and how many of that species they saw, and they just, that's the part of it that they're passionate about, you know. But yeah, tracking your sightings, taking notes, that's a good, easy thing. Everyone's got something they can write on sitting around, so it's low cost and, you know, I think it'd be really useful.
Definitely helps.
I think next would be binoculars.
Optics is huge.
If you can, yeah. The difference between looking at something across your yard with a naked eye and using a pair of binoculars, it just makes everything night and day. And to begin with, you might think, okay, there's 100 million kinds of binoculars and everything like that. I think probably we started with an old military surplus, like Vietnam
era.
It looked like it has Lay's potato chips for lenses.
But it allowed us to see farther.
Yeah.
You know, to see more detail, more clearly. It was bad, but it was better than nothing.
Yeah. There's no limit to what you could spend on optics of any kind. And it's the same with binoculars. You know, if you have the means, get what you can afford. anymore, the glass is so good, it's hard to go bad. You could, yeah, no matter what brand you use, there's obviously brands that are associated with birders that, you know, are more associated with birders, but, you know, it's just whatever you can get. Yeah. It's so good nowadays that it's going to make a huge difference in your ability to identify birds. And so it's a critical must. I think you've had this set of binoculars for since you started birding.
A decade or more, yeah. This only cost me a couple $100s. They're loopholes. A couple things you do want to look for is try and find something in an 8x32, 8x32, mm-hmm, or a 10x42 range. And that's just going to determine kind of your visual, mm-hmm, length on them. You don't want anything too crazy, because, yeah, then you're stuck looking only far away. But if it's too close, then you won't be able to see farther away.
Right.
So you kind of like that middle range. And there's tons of Google articles. You can just type in, you know, best birding binoculars.
Right.
They'll give you a range of options that a lot of people are going to find, yeah, useful.
I would say it would be individualized. Like, say, if you are shakier and you have trouble pulling up your binoculars and finding what you're looking for, an 8 would be probably easier because it gives you a little bit wider field of view. So when you pull up, there's more inside your field of view that you can use to find the bird. If you're more practiced at pointing at what you're looking at and you want a little bit more zoom, then those 10s will narrow that field of view but give you more magnification. So it's just something to consider. You don't want to get 10s or 12s or something like that if you're moving like this when you're trying to look at a bird, or if, like my wife, she pulls up to look at something and it's, you know, 10 feet away from what she's actually trying to see. I don't know, some people can't make that. So. But that would just be a simple consideration as far as, you know, an early direction to go with looking at the powers, just what your physical capabilities are with them.
Absolutely. Then you want to make sure you have some kind of lens protection on the top, especially since a lot of times you're out, you're in the water, you're in the rain, you're in the snow,
mm-hmm,
or whatever. Yeah. So having at least something over the top is really, really helpful.
I lost mine.
Especially on like pelagic trips where there's water everywhere, yeah, it's splashing all around. You definitely want to keep them protected from that salt water, especially. Mm-hmm. But
yeah, so we're both using 8s. They look different. This is more of a the modern birding, I would say,
shape
platform for a binocular. Right. This is more of like a hunting binocular style. But you know, I'm using a Vortex, but they're both 8x42. So the glass is a little different, but both of them look pretty good when you look through them. And we've looked through $1,200, $2,500 binoculars. And there is a difference, but...
You can tell.
I mean, I've been all over the world with this pair of binoculars, and it gets the job done.
Absolutely.
Another thing that doesn't come with binoculars that we got specifically is this X-strap kind of thing that you guys have seen us in all of our episodes wearing, and that just distributes the weight of the binoculars from your neck bones,
it takes it off of
to your
neck,
shoulders, and it's so much more comfortable. I would never ever use a pair of binoculars with it hanging off my neck, because pretty soon you got it pulling on you and you're trying to look for warblers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And what seems like, you know, a really light piece of equipment at the beginning of a day full of birding suddenly becomes like a bag of rocks.
Yeah, and so it just, the way it sits really will put strain, mm-hmm, on your neck, especially over long periods. I mean, yeah, if you're in and out and you're just using them for a couple of, mm-hmm, minutes at a time, 15, 20 minutes at a time, it's no big deal.
Yeah.
But when you're out like us, when you're out for, you know, 8-10 mm-hmm, hours and you're hiking and you're looking up, like you said,
yeah,
it really, really sets in, and you can really put a crick in your neck doing, yeah, that.
And like we said, after the field guide, all of this is just extra. So
this
is something that we did.
They're not expensive.
No.
You know, I think mine costs like $15, yeah, or something like that. You know, it's totally worth the investment. It really makes, yep, a big difference.
It's elastic. It's relaxing. You can pull up. You can set it down. You don't have to worry about it swinging all over the place. You can lean forward and everything. It just, I think it's a great invention. Whoever came up with it, nice
good,
work.
Good job, yeah. And we've used them with all different kinds of packs. You know, a lot of times you see us with the camera, mm-hmm, on one shoulder and the binoculars still strapped under. And because of that elastic, it really works fine. You,
yeah,
know, backpacks, everything. It's no big deal.
My only complaint is it rests right under my belly and like makes me look even bigger.
So. They're adjustable.
I know, but it's so comfortable right here. I think the next thing in optics would be spotting scopes. It's basically... The thought process behind it is identical to binoculars. It gives you a little bit more magnification, or a lot more, depending on what you buy.
Right.
But it's just another really useful piece of equipment, especially if you're going out looking at shorebirds, anything that's, or a waterfowl, something right. that's in the distance that isn't moving all over the place. You wouldn't really be able to go into the backyard and look at chickadees and things like this because they move around so much. And like how I talked about the 8 power to the 10 power with the binoculars, well, these go up, you know, 60x or whatever, zoom and all those kind of things like that. So your field of view is so much smaller but much more magnified. So if that moves at all, it's gone and you have to try and relocate it. So you see us in our videos spending a lot of time trying to adjust and get the right view on what we're looking for. And it takes a little bit of effort. And they come in different profiles with this angled look or a straight on lens. And it's the same as binoculars. There's a million different varieties and everything like that. You just have to look into what you can afford. Try some out, borrow some. You can rent some from like camera shops or things like that. Test them out before you spend money on them. One thing I would say is, you know, that what they call the objective lens here on the end is going to affect how much light goes in. And so that will help you in low light situations when you tend to be out birding early morning, in the evening, things like that, when the light is starting to get a little tense. That bigger that is, the easier it'll be to see, and it'll also help make your image a little crisper. So but the bigger that is, the more expensive it is too. So
yeah, another thing is, like, price wise you're looking at kind of the same thing. You can spend, you know, $2,000 or $40,000 on a spotting scope. It's worth getting, you know, if you have a set of binoculars and you're looking at the next step, this will help a lot. It'll help, like you said, with shorebirds, with, you know, gulls, with anything that's nesting, where getting in close is, you know, morally questionable at best.
Yeah.
You don't want to disturb those birds. This will help you see them, will observe them naturally where they're not disturbed and you're not disturbing them.
Yeah.
And then, again, it just increases your ability to see small details and pick out little,
you know, that's a good point. Like the
markings
ethical
and things like that. But yeah, there's it, the ethical choice behind that is the more you can stay away from the bird and just let them do their thing and not disturb them, the better off you're going to be.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. Next, I think optically would this be camera equipment.
This is a little bit ridiculous. This is not a really expensive setup, but, you know, I think I have like $1,600 into it total. You know, with the camera and the lens together, it's not a quick and easy kind of thing. Now, you can use your phone for a lot of stuff. We have lots of pictures that we were able to just take with our phone.
Yeah.
There's, you know, point and shoot, cheaper point and shoot type cameras that work really well for a lot of things. With what we're doing, we're trying to get pictures of birds that are much farther away and get, you know, much crisper pictures of that. So you end up spending more money depending on what you want to do.
Right. For us, we're not required. Like, to identify birds, you don't need nearly as good of a picture, really. You know, you can't really judge the equipment we're using on our trips that you're watching, because we're trying to also capture stuff to show you guys.
Right.
And so we're trying to get the best pictures we can, so you know, it's not only identifiable in the video, but also so it's at least aesthetically pleasing a little bit.
A little.
You know, we do our best. Our video of birds, you know, we are using this as the platform for filming birds, and it's challenging at best.
Right.
You know, so that's something we're going to look at upgrading in the future. But you're going to see us with equipment that you don't need to go birding. It's just the combination of the filming and the birding.
Right.
But so, you know, before he had a much simpler setup with the camera, and it worked just good enough. And so the point is, if you have a camera, you're basically taking what the naturalists 100 years ago, when they're trying to quickly sketch a bird and write down markings and things like that so they can use them to identify, and you're making that process instantaneous. And when I first started birding, the thing that helped me make the biggest jump was carrying around a camera, because there's so many things and you can't memorize all the markings and things like that. So I would see something and I would photograph it, and then I could go back and cross-reference it with the field guide and that.
Right.
really helped me.
So you're looking at a picture of a bird that you saw for a few seconds, mm-hmm. and then sitting down with a field guide and just going through until you figure out exactly what it is.
Yeah.
It helps you really slow down and then work through it on your time instead of on the bird's time, where it might be just a fleeting moment.
And then if you do have a picture, you can use online resources. You can put it on forums and things like that. All different kind of forums have bird identification groups. You can just Google search and you can just become a member. Everyone I've looked at was for free. You just put them on there and people say, I think it's this, and there might be a little back and forth, but eventually people will come to a consensus. You'll decide who you can trust and who are not as experienced, but eventually it'll just help you learn those things. And I think it's a really valuable tool to help you, because it's hard to just go out with nothing and just look at birds and try and identify them all until much farther down the road from the new birder.
Right. So always make that effort though, because that's how you're going to learn. Mm-hmm. You know, but if you get a bird where you're just stumped and you can't figure it out, you're just confused, or it looks like one bird and it looks like another bird and you can't tell the difference, a lot of those groups will get on there. People will help you and they'll say, look, this is what it is and this is why. And they'll say, you know, it's because of these markings, or it's because of this location, or it's because, you know, you live in this geographic location at this time, and that's why we think it's this bird, you know.
Yeah.
So it's a lot of those steps where it's gonna force you to work through with them to understand, you know, how you identify birds. And again, we have, you know, a previous episode, if you haven't already watched it, we use a system called Salutes, so that you can take your time and work through those steps. But those steps will get you, if not every single bird, will get you close enough so you can say, I'm pretty sure this was it.
Yeah. And you see us all the time. You know, hopefully by now you've seen our process. And a lot of times our process results with, we're not sure.
And sometimes.
It just happens.
You just don't know.
You know, but that's what makes it fun. If you knew everything that you went out to see, you know, it wouldn't be as much of an adventure.
Yep.
I think after this kind of physical equipment, I think the next thing would be stuff that you guys probably could figure out yourself. Proper clothing,
right?
You know, sunscreen, bug spray, water, hydration,
absolutely,
you know, those kind of things. A little bit extra cash, because you're going to get hungry snacking out, you know. You're going to want to go and
right,
you might have a plan, but then after you have a good morning of birding, you're like, all right, let's go. Let's get something to eat or something. Like,
grab
that
another hot cup of coffee.
Let's see here. Yeah,
any clothing. Of that is, it's going to be situational. Yeah. Depends on what you're doing. You know, if you're on a pelagic trip, obviously you're going to have different clothing than if you're, you know, out in Southern California looking for parakeets or something, you know.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I don't think we need to beat the clothing to it. You know, pulp.
Use common sense.
If you go out and it's cold, you need more clothes. If you go out and you're wet, you need rain gear.
Right.
But I think in general, we tend to, if we're going on a trip, we bring a little bit of everything. Hear those wax wings all over the place. All over, right up here. Whole mess of wax wings moving in through the pine trees over here.
Even when we're filming videos, we're birding.
Always birding. So,
that's kind of a rough overall. Yeah. The basics of what you're going to need.
Yeah.
There's a lot of leeway in what it is.
Yeah.
There's a lot of difference in quality and the price. Like Steve says, you know, it's whatever you're comfortable with, whatever you're able to spend. Obviously, when it comes to optics, you know, if you can afford the Hubble telescope, that's going to give you a better picture quality. It's going to be crisper photos. You don't need, as far as cameras go, unless you're specifically taking pictures for photography, you're not going to need, you know, the $30,000 lens.
No.
You're not going to need like this camera. Like Steve said, I started with like a Rebel, Canon Rebel, with just like a 150 to 300 zoom on it, and that worked excellent for years, just for taking pictures and hammering down, you know, basic identifications and stuff like that. So that worked great for me for years. And then when we decided to start doing this to try and get pictures so that you can put them online so that other people can also recognize them.
And nowadays they
stepped
have,
up, so,
you know, adapters that you can hook your phone onto a spotting scope, or, you know, hook it up to your binoculars if you need to. You know, you just need a little tripod, get all that stuff together, you can use your phone. So you don't even have to buy a dedicated camera body or anything like that. If you say, I've got to pick between a camera and a spotting scope, you can make those kind of adjustments. So, right. You know, but I would recommend to begin with going out, trying other people's stuff, get involved with some people who know optics. It might not necessarily be birders, but there's other people out there, just photographers that might let you borrow some stuff. Hunters use all the same equipment basically. Anymore, they're filming and using spotting scopes and using binoculars, and they have all the adapters in that community.
Right.
You know, Sporting Goods Place will let you look through their spotting scopes and stuff like that for their own selfish reasons. They'll try and help you pick something.
But if you do come across another birder, I've never met another birder who wasn't more than happy to let you look through a spotting scope while he was looking at something.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great community. People are more than happy to share and just be honest with them. Just say, hey, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm brand new to this. I'm, you know, looking at different optics, or I'm looking at binoculars. Mm-hmm. You know, what do you use?
Yeah, ask them questions. Yeah, I got these Vietnam War binoculars and I can't really see very good. Can I see what those look like? And they'll be like, sure, have a look. And you'll look through them and you're like, holy smokes,
that's wow, a lot better, it's a whole different
than it
world.
Was in the 60s or 70s. So, but yeah. It's just something, and if you guys have any questions, of course, you can comment underneath. We can give you our thoughts on different things, but in general, our thoughts are go with what you can afford and what you can bring, because bad binoculars are better than no binoculars. And
yeah, if it comes down to a choice between, you know, not knowing what to buy or not being able to buy something and going birding, always the choice is go birding. So.
Yeah. Yeah, like we said, you don't need any of this stuff to go enjoy birds, and that's what we really want you guys to do, is just see how much fun it can be and how enjoyable it is. And
yep, absolutely.
And eventually all this stuff will just come to you over the years, and pretty soon you'll be helping somebody who's holding a junky piece of binocular and helping them out and teaching them what you have learned. So
yep,
we appreciate you guys tuning in to our next educational episode.
Yep, thank you for watching.
We'll see you on the next one.
Get birding.